In this video lecture, we're going to see how to add an equals method to our new person class, which will allow us to test field by field for object equality. Okay, let's get started. As we've already seen in the prior lecture materials, we don't simply want to use the equality operator to compare two objects for equality. Instead, it's considered good standard design practice when creating a new Java class to always provide a standard equals method. A couple things of note about this equals method. First, it always has a standard API interface, which will be common to any Java class. Second, it determines the true data equality of two objects by checking their data field by field. If every instance variable of one object is equal to the corresponding instance variable of a second object, we say those two objects are truly equal, and equals will return a true result. However, if even so much as one instance variable between the two objects differs, equals will return a false result. Harsh perhaps, but thorough. Finally, to implement an equals method, we're going to need one new Java capability, the instance of operator, which will tell us up front whether or not we're performing an apples-to-apples comparison between like-typed objects. We'll get to this in a moment. First, here is the standard interface for the equals method. And when I say standard, I mean that every Java class that implements this will use this common generic form. The equals method determines whether the data in one object is equivalent to the data in another object. This method takes as its one input some object of the most general generic class there is, the object class with a capital O. All this is saying is that equals will accept as input objects of any class type. This method returns a Boolean value, true if the data in the two objects is identical, or false otherwise. Here's an example of how to use equals. Suppose we have two CS12 date objects, date 1 and date 2. We can compare the month, day, and year of either object against the other one using this syntax. We pick one of the dates as our current reference object, then invoke the equals method upon it using dot notation as usual, with the other date as the method's input. If the month, day, and year of date 1 is equivalent to the month, day, and year of date 2, this entire expression in blue evaluates to one Boolean true or false value, and the appropriate outcome message will be printed. Hopefully this looks familiar from a past assignment on CS12 date. Now in the previous method interface definition, note that we said the input was of the generic object type, which means that the two objects being compared don't even have to be of the same class type. When implementing an equals method, the first thing we need to do is check whether the current reference object and the input object are indeed of the same type. In other words, are we trying to do an apples-to-apples comparison or not? We check this using the new Java keyword instance of, which is actually a Boolean binary operator. As you can see in this general form, instance of has two operands, one on each side. The left operand is the name of some object variable, and the right operand is the name of some class, as indicated by this initial capital. We're asking the question, is this object one of these, yes or no? This entire expression evaluates to one Boolean value. So we incorporate this into a new equals method as follows. First, we use instance of to check if two objects are of some common class type. If they're not, stop. We're doing an apples to bananas comparison, so there's no point to checking further. But if they are of the same class type, then we would cast the generic object into the more specific class type and then continue checking instance variables field by field, because now we know we're making an apples-to-apples comparison. Let's take a look at an example of how all this is done. Here's a code example for the starter equals method of our person class. Remember, this method interface on the first line will always be the same for all classes you implement. First off, in this outer if-else logic, we first want to check whether we're comparing two like-typed objects or not. So we start by testing if our generic input object, OBJ, is in reality a person object. If that's not the case, stop. We're not comparing two person objects. So there's really no point in checking further, and we can simply return a false outcome right now. Otherwise, in this else branch, we now know that this generic input object, OBJ, in reality is one of us. It's a person object in disguise. So the next thing we do is to typecast that generic object OBJ into a person object P. And from this point forward, P will represent the input person object we're comparing against. Finally, in this inner if-else branch, we begin checking individual instance variables against each other. To make what's what very clear, we're going to preface each instance variable as follows. This dot will refer to the current person object we're in, and P dot will refer to the input person object we're checking against. So inside this if branch, we check each of the instance variables against their counterpart. If all of the instance variables match up, we return a true from this method. Otherwise, if so much as one instance variable differs, we'd return this false result instead. Now notice that right now we're only comparing the one instance variable we've implemented so far. We're going to see very soon that it will be very easy to extend this comparison for all the other needed instance variables by adding on logical AND clauses. Also, notice that here we're comparing two first names against each other, and both are strings. So this equals inside here represents the equals method of the string class to compare two strings. This p.getFirstName itself is a string, so we're simply invoking a string method upon it. In general, make sure to use the right type of comparison pertinent to the data. We've seen how to perform each of these comparisons now. For any object types, use their class's equals method. For floating point values, use the absolute value and a tolerance. And for integers, here you can safely use a simple equality operator. At the end of this lecture segment, you can take a look at the cited source code example or its code walkthrough for more details. When we talked about display methods in an earlier lecture segment, we said that overriding a method means to mask or replace its existing default version with your own version of that same method. And one example we saw of this was toString. The equals method that you create in any new class represents another example of overriding a method. The object class, the ultimate Uber ancestor of all Java classes, already provides a default equals method, but it's considered good software practice to always explicitly override this method by replacing it with your own version. If you want to experiment and demonstrate this, try commenting out your own equals method and see what happens. Chances are the results won't be as you expect. Speaking of which, let's see how to actually test and use our new equals method. We've said before that it's a good incremental development practice to always test our new methods as we implement them. Here's some test code we'll add to our person class main method to test the equals method. It's a good idea to always, at a minimum, perform the following three tests. First, compare two different objects against each other. Chances are that they'll be different and return a false result. So in this first test, we're comparing two existing person objects, P1 and P2, and getting this false result. Second, always compare one object against itself, and it had better be equal to itself. So in the second test, we compare the person object P2 against itself and get the expected true result. If this is anything but true, you need to go back into the comparison statement of your equals method and debug it some more. Third, always compare an object against another object of some other class so as to test your instance of logic. So in this third test, we set up an object of some other type, in this case a string, but it could be a CS12 date or any other class type. Then we compare it to a person object like so, and check to see that we get the expected false result. Just as an aside, because the equals method returns a simple Boolean result, these three simple checks should suffice, and this test code should remain unchanged no matter how many more instance variables we add. To finish up, please take a moment now to view the demo video for PersonPhase7.java, where we'll demonstrate creating and testing an equals method for our person class. Okay, that's it for now on creating an equality method in a new class.